What's up, folks? Hope I'm getting this in on time. I want to, and and about the time, the whole thing ready, waiting for the moment. Kvetching in my ear.
Try hitting Control-Alt-Delete.
When this kind of fun starts, it is very hard to play out.
Category D, Industry.
All right, that's Nirvana on 90.3 FM KUSF, and we are in the studio with Consolidated. Welcome. How you guys doing today?
Yeah, right. Good. How you, Phil?
Right. I'm fine. Hey, serious stuff going on in the world, and we're going to talk all about it. But first, I want to ask you this. A lot of people talk to me. They mention, they go, Consolidated, they're a bunch of hypocrites. How do you respond to that?
Well, I'd say, yeah, we are hypocrites.
Coded message
to the left.
Captain Morrell. Command and Communications Center.
Yes.
Next.
Staring at the screen won't fix it. Tried checking your gigabytes.
Extrasensory perception.
Sight, smell, taste, touch, hearing. What thoughts and feelings are communicated.
communicated without speaking. This mixed message may subtly teach children not to trust extrasensory perception.
I don't think anybody's been able to figure it out.
The spoken word.
We are not going anywhere.
But, I like, absurd things, basically.
No, no, right click on my computer.
Angelo Badalamenti has many film scores to his credit, but he also is the man responsible for the haunting sound of ABC's Twin Peaks.
Sometimes you hear a piece of music and it marries to a scene in the script. When I'm shooting, I will often play that piece of music in headphones while listening to the dialogue. Hearing the music is just a verification that things are going the right way. For instance, the right pace or lighting. It's just another tool to ensure that you're following the original idea and being true to it. So it's a good thing if you've got some music up front to play to see if the scene works. Sound is so important to the feel of a film. To get the right presence for a room, the right feel from the outside, or the right sounding dialogue is like playing a musical instrument. You have to do a lot of experimenting to get it just right. It usually happens after the film is cut. But I'm always trying to gather what I call firewood, so I have piles of things I can go to and see if they'll work. You just have to pop one sound in and you realize right away. Dreams. I love dream logic. I just like the way dreams go, but I have hardly ever gotten ideas from dreams. I get more ideas from music or just walking around. May everyone be happy. May everyone be free of disease. May auspiciousness be seen everywhere. May suffering belong to no one. Peace. This is David Lynch. All rights reserved. I've worked with Angelo Badalamenti since Blue Velvet, and I love Angelo like a brother, and he can write, as you all know if you've heard his music, music that'll tear your heart out, and great stuff. But in the beginning, he doesn't know, because a lot of times we start before the shooting has begun, so I sit next to him and I talk to him. And he plays what I say. And then, like just like everything else, I adjust if it's not going a certain way. And he'll keep playing. And in a very short amount of time, he's playing the thing that's marrying to the ideas. And once he catches the right road, he goes.
Quiet.
absurd things.
There have been no calls today. What did she say?
Hey, what's up, Doc? It's Laura Palmer, in case you haven't guessed. I'm making you another one of these tapes, which, as you already know, I've mailed you in one of the envelopes you gave me. It's Thursday, the 23rd. I'm so bored.
Ooh, mystic.
Actually, I'm in kind of a weird mood. God, James is sweet, but he's so dumb. I should have met you a long time ago, Dr. Jacoby, because right now I can take just so much of sweet. I just know I'm gonna get lost in those woods again tonight. I just know it.
Of an invitation to love.
Carol? Carol? For God's sake, listen to reason.
Reason, Chet? Since when have I ever needed a reason to do anything?
But Jared's your father.
And Jade's my sister.
And Jade's my wife.
I'm sorry. But Emerald, you know your father loves you. He loves you both.
Well, with all his financial difficulties, and he's been out of the hospital less than a week.
Does that mean I'm supposed to suffer too?
For God's sake, his pains are real. And you shouldn't have talked to Jade that way when she was with him in the hospital.
Jade, Jade, Jade. Everyone's worried about Jade.
It's because people care about her. Because she's a kind and loving person. Not like...
Not like me? There was a time when you wanted my love, Chet. You want like nothing else in this world.
Our marriage is in the past. Experience is a great and bitter teacher.
So is money. Chet, you're a fool. And Jade's a fool. But my father's the biggest fool of all.
So what does that make me?
Montana?
Hello, beautiful.
I knew you'd come back.
Sight. But I remember baby. Each and every night. Take you now, girl.
Of innocence burn first, and the wind rises, and then all goodness is in jeopardy.
Invitation to Love will return.
Extraordinary, no matter what it is. Ask the cosmic void. We knew you would. Come, won't you join us? Now that you're dead, you've nothing to worry about.
Welcome, Angelo Badalamenti. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
I never told anybody this, but once for about 3 days, just before her time, Teresa's arm went completely dead.
What do you mean?
Her left arm. It was numb. She said she couldn't use it. Probably those drugs she was taking. I just thought I ought to tell you.
Thanks.
Are you talking about that little girl that got murdered?
Invitation to Love, starring Martin Padley as Chet, Selena Swift as Emerald and Jade, Evan St. Vincent as Jared Lancaster, and Jason Denbo as Montana.
We didn't expect to see you back here in town so soon, Montana.
I had a change of direction.
So, Montana, tell me, did you find that rainbow you were looking for?
Plenty of rainbows. No pot of gold.
I'm not sure how I'm feeling about this.
Chet, shut up and get Montana a drink. Must be absolutely parched after 18 months in a rainforest.
How long are you planning to stay here in town, Montana?
Long enough to see you two. And my ex-wife. Tell me, Chet, how is Jade?
Invitation to Love. We'll be right back.
So the man can say, "Ooh, look at me. I've got JFK's rocker in my living room. I'm so important."
Do I hear $300,000? $300,000. I'm as good as the Kennedys because I've got them wronger. Do I hear $500,000? There's $500,000. Oh, I'm rocking back and forth on my front porch at gay rocker. I'm gay rocker. Look at me. I'm gay. Going once, going twice. Sold. To gay. Next lot, 33, Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy's black bead necklace. We'll start the bidding at $2,500. Ladies and gentlemen, these were first worn by the First Lady when she met French President Charles de Gaulle.
Oh, my cameo in Paris, bonjour, Charles de Gaulle. I have $2,500, I'm a princess. Oh, just take them, no more bidding.
Lot number 34, Kennedy's cedar and mahogany humidor bearing the monogram of JFK. Before we start the bidding, the humidor has something it would like to say.
Oh, please, Mr. Sotheby, don't sell me to these vultures. They're not JFK. They're just a bunch of creepy Camelot wannabes. Don't let them put their stinky cigars in me.
It's all right. It's not all right. It's all right. It's not all right.
Kids, if you've trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, God has a will for your life. You know what that will is?
The Lord has a will, and I have a need. Follow that will, the holy be still, rest in it,
that's an interesting song, isn't it?
It sure is, Dad.
Let's talk about God's will for your life today, okay?
You mean the type of work I'm going to do someday, Dad?
Tim, is that what you think I mean when I say God's will for your life?
Yeah, sure.
Well, that's God's will way down the road somewhere. But how about his will for your life today, right now?
Oh, I hadn't thought of that. I suppose his will for my life is, you know, right now that I know Jesus Christ is my personal Savior. And I do.
Super. Okay, now, is there anything beyond that?
I really don't know for sure, Dad. Does the Bible say anything about this?
Sure does, Tim. It's loaded.
And where should I turn?
By Romans chapter 12, verse 2.
Okay, Romans 12, 2.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, at the Church of Rome, the will of God is that which is good and acceptable and perfect in God's sight.
Okay, that was the Apostle Paul. So, Tim, how important is God's will?
Okay, Romans 12:2 says the will of God is good, acceptable, and perfect in God's sight.
Isn't that interesting?
Really, it is. God thinks it's important for us Christians to know his will for our life.
And the best part of it, God's will is for right now.
Today.
That's right. And he tells us how he wants us to live as believers in Christ today.
And that's his will, or what he wants.
You've got it, Tim.
Dad, Okay, what does God want for my life today? Or what is his will for my life today as a believer?
Okay, son. Quite a few places in the New Testament, God talks to Christians, and he says, this is my will for all Christians. It's the same.
Really? Where's one of those verses, Dad?
1 Thessalonians chapter 4.
Okay, 1 Thessalonians 4.
Brothers and sisters, Paul speaking.
Thank you. Brothers and sisters in Christ in Thessalonica, since you have trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, let me tell you this. It is God's will now that you live a holy life.
That we should be holy. What does that mean, Paul? What are you saying?
Yeah. All right, the word means that you should be very, very close to the Lord and very, very far away from sin.
Yeah, that's interesting. I didn't know that. That's how God wants us to live.
Well, that's right. That's for sure. Now, let me tell you exactly what God said. As you know, brothers and sisters, here in Thessalonica, there is a lot of immorality.
It's a terrible place to bring up children.
Yes, indeed. Therefore, the Lord said you as Christians should live a holy life. Have absolutely nothing to do with sexual immorality. The Lord said, you are to learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. That's what it means to be holy. Separated unto God and separated from sin.
Oh, Dad, I can tell I need that. I mean, you should see some of the dirty magazines the kids bring to school.
You can see how immoral your own age group is, can't you?
Sure can, Dad. And they expect me to laugh at their dirty jokes, too.
Isn't it really sick that kids make jokes about their bodies?
Some of the kids brag about what they do with their bodies.
I know it. A lot of men talk that way, too, son. But what does the Word of God say to us?
It says, as believers in Jesus Christ, that it's God's will that we should be holy. And that we should have absolutely nothing to do with sexual immorality.
We have bought a record for you. Would you like to listen to it?
I'm not sure.
Would you like to hear that record on sex again?
I don't understand.
I brought some drawings so that you can actually see the things I'm going to describe.
Mm-hmm.
There is a larger opening called the vagina.
Man.
The vagina is capable of being stretched a great deal.
What are testicles?
Testicles.
Mm-hmm.
The testicles manufacture seed. When too much of this seed is produced, it overflows and comes out of the penis, usually during the night when a boy or man is asleep. This is called a wet dream. Sometimes boys worry about this, but it's really nothing to worry about at all. It's a perfectly normal, natural thing.
Boys are rough and noisy.
Well, that's not at all unusual.
Does menstruation hurt?
Sometimes a girl may have a little headache or an uncomfortable feeling in her stomach. Some girls feel blue, upset, and cross. They may cry easily and lose their tempers over nothing. And they may use menstruation as an excuse for being rude and mean. It may be pretty hard to live with. Some girls imagine they feel worse than they actually do. They get in a dither just by thinking too much about themselves. So pay no attention to a little ache or two. Now that you know what you can expect these few days every month, learn to live with them easily. They needn't upset you. After all, menstruation is so right and normal. Once you understand it and how little bother it is, paying attention to it makes about as much sense as worrying over your breathing.
Man.
I want to tell you about something else. Never refer to the menstrual period as the monthly period. It's better to speak of the curse, or sick days, or falling off the roof. This is all quite normal.
It sure is.
This is called an erection.
Why is that?
The penis is made up largely of a special tissue that is full of small pockets, something like a sponge material. Sometimes blood is pumped from the arteries into this material. This makes the penis get larger and become hard.
Thoroughn 미국, fucking USA입니다.
Aprons hang on hooks like sides of beef.
Suffocating rubber clown suit. It would be easier to roll up the entire sky into a small cloth than it would be to obtain true happiness without knowing the self. From the Upanishads. When I started meditating, I was filled with anxieties and fears. I felt a sense of depression and anger. I took out this anger on my first wife. After I had been meditating for about 2 weeks, she came to me and said, "What's going on?" I was quiet for a moment, but finally I said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "This anger, where did it go?" And I hadn't even realized that it had lifted. I call that depression and anger the suffocating rubber clown suit of negativity. It's suffocating, and that rubber stinks. But once you start meditating and diving within, the clown suit starts to dissolve. You finally realize how putrid was the stink when it starts to go. Then when it dissolves, you have freedom. Anger and depression and sorrow are beautiful things in a story, but they're like poison to the filmmaker or artist. They're like a vice grip on creativity. If you're in that grip, you can hardly get out of bed, much less experience the flow of creativity and ideas. You must have clarity to create. You have to be able to catch ideas.
This is the keyboard that all the major themes were created for Twin Peaks. It's an old Fender Rhodes and kind of beat up. And David would sit right over here, right to the right of me, and we would put a little cassette just about over here on this keyboard, just keep it in record and just keep it playing.
Teresa Banks had a ring. Any idea what happened to it?
We got a phone here. Got a little ring.
Did you hear the crickets? Crickets produce their chirps by rubbing their wings together.
Why don't you have a seat over there with your partner? Go ahead, make yourself at home. Because it's going to be a while. Why don't you have some coffee, go ahead. It was fresh about 2 days ago.
David would sit here and I'd say, "Well, what do you see, David?"
Take the van back to Portland, Stanley. I'm gonna take one more look at the trailer park.
Agent Desmond, one thing has been troubling me. The Blue Rose. You're going back to the trailer park for the Blue Rose.
That's Deputy Cliff's trailer right there with that red truck. That's his truck, Tilly.
And Teresa Banks' trailer's over here,
right where we left.
Where's my goddamn hot water? Hot water, Carl.
I
want to get you some
Valium. Remember me telling you about that mystery man? Well,
have you ever considered becoming a KPFA monthly sustainer?
KPFA monthly sustainer?
It's quick, it's easy, And it helps KPFA stand united and strong.
United and strong.
By providing us income we can rely on. And unlike the other subscription streaming services that are out there, becoming a KPFA monthly sustainer actually gives something back to your community with vital information, discussion, music, and thought-provoking content that speaks truth to power. Just visit kpfa.org/support and click monthly. From there, you can select how much per month you feel comfortable contributing. And with enough help, we can shrink our fund drive goals and maybe even shorten the fund drives themselves. We can't do without. So please go to kpfa.org
and become a recurring donor today.
And do your part to keep KPFA going strong and remaining vigilant as always. We thank you. Jack Hirschman.
And that people both older and younger than you, a billion strong, will say, we don't want you to make war anymore anywhere on Earth. If you do, we will stop you and your weapons of mass destruction without even a shot being fired. With a majority, you're an unruly child. Go to the corner and learn your lesson. Then, America, finally, you'll be free.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org.
You did have a life before David Lynch. Can you tell us a little bit about
I actually started out when I graduated from, I went to Eastman School of Music in Rochester and Manhattan School of Music, and wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do. And I taught school in Brooklyn, New York for 5 years. I taught music and English. I don't know how they got English there, but I taught music and some English, and I was writing songs as I was a teacher, and then
pop songs.
Uh-huh. I loved pop songs, and though I was a classically trained musician, being a French hornist was my major, uh-huh. You know, played a little bit of piano, and a publisher then offered me a position to join him and be a full-time music writer. And offered me $50 a week. And I thought about it for a long time, about a day and a half. And I took the job and resigned from teaching, though I loved teaching, and just started with writing songs and arranging and orchestrating and records and singers and doing all those things that's necessary to survive in the capricious music business. And, you know, some other films, and things just kept developing. You know, I like to think that I can cover most of those bases, because if the music is good, it really doesn't matter, you know, what the style is, you know. And I enjoy working on all of it.
Uh-huh. So now, how did you get hooked up with David Lynch?
4 years ago, when David was just completing the shooting of Blue Velvet, I think it's about 4 years, whatever that is, I received a phone call from my friend Peter Renfilo and Fred Caruso, who are both movie producers and working on Blue Velvet. And they needed a vocal coach for Isabella Rossellini. And I was home that day, and I received that very important phone call. And Fred said to me, would you get on a plane tomorrow morning and work with Isabella Rossellini? And I said, we just need... You know, we're having a little bit of problems just having someone work, you know, with her to coach her on the song Blue Velvet, the old standard. And they knew that I had worked with singers as well, and I'd love doing that. And I said, absolutely. And I thought about it. Well, it can't be so bad. She is half Italian, and everyone knows that Italians can sing. So how far off the mark could you be? In any case, I went out there, worked with Isabella. It worked out very nicely, made a demo, brought it to the set where David was shooting the last scene of Blue Velvet, put on his phones, he heard it, he loved it, asked me to record her with a band, go in, do an arrangement on the song. We did that, He loved that. And then it was the start of our relationship. He then asked me to compose a song for Blue Velvet, which was turned out to be Mysteries of Love, which was a very important song for Blue Velvet. And he wrote a lyric, I did the music. Then he asked me to compose the score, and that was the start of our thing.
My darling daughter Jade, and Emerald, because of my financial difficulties, I have decided to end it all tonight. I hope you can find the strength to go on without me, your loving father, Jared. Jared Lancaster have decided to leave the Towers, a complex owned by me, solely to my daughter Jade.
Today because of the dream I told you about.
Daddy, it's Jade! Daddy, please! I know you're in there!
Jade, what a surprise. I wasn't expecting it.
Oh, Daddy, don't pretend. Not with me. Not anymore.
Jade,
I know the pain you've been going through. And Chet's told me about your financial difficulties. Daddy, listen to me. You mustn't give up. You have so much to live for.
Jade, the awful truth is I have nothing.
Oh, Danny, that's not true.
Gordon!
You have me.
Gordon!
You have my love and devotion.
Gordon.
Jade. My beautiful Jade. What a foolish, old, selfish idiot I've been. How could I have ever doubted that?
How do we do that? What?
Yeah.
A hearing aid is a highly technical device.
Corporate.
Yes, 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says we can learn to control our own body in a way that is holy and honorable.
He's got it. And God says that's his will for our lives as believers in Christ. That's his will for our lives today.
Boy, that's a real challenge.
You know it, son. To be able to control our own body in a way that's holy and honorable to God. Okay, Jim. Every believer in Jesus Christ has God the Holy Spirit living in him.
My body is his home, literal.
That's right. Next time we're tempted to be immoral, like Paul said, remember, God the Holy Spirit lives there.
Dad, that means if I read a dirty sex magazine, that I make the Holy Spirit read it with me.
You're right. And the Bible says that grieves him.
Boy, Dad, that really helps me.
Great. Here's one from Galatians 5:23 that will help you. The fruit of the Spirit is self-control.
Ah, that's how the Holy Spirit is. He is self-control, and I have him living in me, so therefore, I can have self-control.
Sure we can, son. The Holy Spirit is self-control. We have him, and we can have self-control then.
That way I can learn to control my own body in a way that's holy and honorable to God, just like Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 4:3.
Sure. Now, when you feel the temptation to be immoral, pray to God and say, Holy Spirit, you live in me. You are self-controlled. I'm calling on you right now to give me that self-control so I can learn to control my own body in a way that's holy and honorable.
As God said, that's my will for your life.
after these messages. To love will return after these messages.
Dat is High Fidelity. High Fidelity is een opwindend belevenis van de verwerkelijking uw muzikale wensdromen door technische vervolmaking. Luister naar een voorbeeld. Het is eenvoudig niet te begrijpen dat deze muziek ooit volmaakter zou kunnen worden gereproduceerd. Zo zei de grammofoonliefhebber van circa een halve eeuw geleden. En dat is nu High Fidelity. Dit verbluffend verschil volgt uit de mogelijkheden welke zich in de loop van de laatste 50 jaar hebben ontwikkeld.
They're not ordinary people. There's all sorts of examples.
You know, you can write the Star Spangled Banner.
And you know,
No, that was one of the big mistakes of my life. not really, of course. I asked for lyrics. I thought I would, and he thought that would be an impossible task to have, you know, a song written just on the spot like this. Especially, David really knows what he wants. Especially when he listens to existing records and he falls in love with those things. It's very hard to turn David around into something new. So. But they did ask me is it possible? And I said, I'm not a lyricist, I do need lyrics. Ask David for some lyrics. And he reluctantly agreed, and he wrote six lines, which had no rhymes, no meter, no hooks, as we know hooks. And it was really like a six-line sonnet. Yeah, right, exactly. And I looked at it, and I said, oh my goodness, what am I going to do with this? And I called David, and he said, well, just make it very beautiful and very sustained and very cosmic and make it like the wind and the oceans and waves. Oh, I said, well, now I understand what that is.
coming, eh? There we are. balloon floats up towards the moon, reflected down, and soon your heart beats with my tune. Balloon, my thought balloon, as you read through, and soon we'll swim in a lagoon of love's unfettered soon.
So we don't know the origin of the object. So the aircraft that took down the object was an F-22 flying out of Joint Base Elmendorf in Alaska. It employed an A-9X to take down the object. terms of, again, we will know more, but again, we'll know more. And in terms of entering the United States, it did enter U.S. airspace, and we took it down. Yeah, so again, since this particular object, no. And so again, we'll know more later. Again, right now, we'll know more once we assess it. We'll just leave it at that.
What is different about this object than the last object?
Yeah, so we're continuing to assess that. Again, I'm not able to go into more detail other than, in addition to learning a lot about the balloon and the capabilities that it has while it was over the continental United States, we have identified or located a significant amount of debris on the ocean floor that will be very beneficial to us learning more about it. But at this point in time, I'm not going to have more detail. Yeah, so you know, the important thing to understand here is anytime we detect anything, we're going to, first of all, observe it. We go here and up. Look, again, we're going to judge each of these objects on its own merits. It entered into U.S. airspace on February 9th. We sent up aircraft to assess what it was. The decision was made that it posed a reasonable threat to civilian air traffic. The president gave the order to take it down, and we took it down.
Has anything like this happened before with an object this size, this shape, in this particular height, for the 40,000 foot range?
So in terms of this particular object, again, as I highlighted, we don't know where it's from.
Can you say more about why you knew that last balloon or object was from China, whereas this one you don't know?
We have learned a lot about the Chinese surveillance high altitude balloon program.
So would you urge us to put this in a different bucket than that, or should we?
Yeah, I think I was pretty clear. Yeah, so let me be clear. The answer is no. That's not acceptable behavior. When we detect objects, let me just back up. So what you're asking is, this was traveling at about 40,000 feet, which posed a reasonable threat to civilian air traffic, and the decision was made to take it down. So, now. I would say that, again, we'll know more and have more information once we've recovered this. In terms of the Chinese motivations, again, I'd have to refer you back to China to talk about that. I don't have that information for me, so I don't want to make it up. I don't, at this point, considering the fact that we're still assessing the object, I don't want to get into characterizing it along its track. It's our assessment that this was a purposeful mission. In terms of, again, we don't know the point of origin of this object.
Was there any effort to jam?
I don't want to get into specific tactics or techniques that we may or may not use when observing these types of things. I'm not able to go into more detail other than we've discovered or located a significant amount of the debris associated with the balloon. Again, we'll have more details to follow, but in terms of what's in that report and what's not in that report, again, you can go back and look at that, but I can tell you, I can assure you that there are a lot of activities that we continue to monitor to include this balloon program, and we've learned a lot of that. I'd have to go back and look. I do not know the answer.
The only reason the American people know about the first balloon is because a couple of guys in Montana spotted it and it leaked out. My question is, if it had remained secret and had not become a spectacle and arguably an embarrassment to the White House, would you have shot it down or allowed it to continue on its way?
You're asking me to speculate? So I'll kind of just push back a little bit at the assertion there. So first of all, again, what made this balloon different was the length and duration that it was over the United Continental United States. Yeah, Joe, we'll get you more information on that front. You know, again, this happened just a short while ago, but we'll have more information in terms of the various roles and responsibilities. Look, we track activities all over the globe on a daily basis, some of which will remain classified because, again, we don't want to reveal sources and methods. In this particular case, I can tell you that there were efforts underway to make that public. Montana journalists reporting notwithstanding. All that to say, look, there are going to be times when there's activities happening that we're monitoring that we're not going to go public, especially if it doesn't present a particular or pose a significant threat to the American public. But again, as we monitored that balloon, there was an effort underway to ensure that folks understood what this was, especially given how visible it was. Kind of a little bit of apples and oranges, right? In terms of, again, we're still assessing what this object was. So I don't know that we learned anything new as a result of that, other than, again, I think we're all, to include the media and the public, very attuned to balloons at the moment. So thank you. Yes, sir.
At this point, is the Pentagon reassessing the need for counter balloon or counter object capabilities at that altitude at this time?
We're continuing to learn more about this program, which enables us to identify and track objects. I mean, again, so this literally was, an hour and a half, 2 hours ago? So that's underway right now. So more to follow on that. We can get you that information. Thanks. My understanding is it was at 40,000 feet when it was detected and ultimately taken down. The NORAD, NORTHCOM commander, does not have the authority necessarily to take down an object if it's not posing potential hostile intent or actions after consultation with the secretary and the president. Of course, the president, on our advice, gave the order to take it down and took it down. Again, it's kind of a moot point at this point because the president gave the order, but he has the authorization to take action against anything that presents a potential threat to the American public or people on the ground. Again, I'll just leave it at that. Thanks.
What is, just talk to me.
Okay, well, this was an object, right? So it wasn't an aircraft, per se. I'll have to come back to you on it. I think I know, but I don't want to make it up to everybody, so we'll come back to you on that one. Okay, thank you very much, everybody. I appreciate it.
I've learned to interpret that, those kinds of descriptions.
Thank you.
I wouldn't call it a dream. It's Ultron's base consciousness. Information comes
soon. Have a seat. I'm not being pushy.
We're encrypted. Question one.
Stay tuned for more Invitation to Love. Following these messages.
Isabel Wilkerson.
All of those people that you listen to in Motown, they are all the children of the Great Migration. In fact, many of them might not have existed had there been no Great Migration. Diana Ross's parents, for example, her mother migrated from Alabama and her father from West Virginia. They met in Detroit, and here you have it. The same with the others in the Supremes. Aretha Franklin, her parents had come up from the South as well. The Jackson Five, the mother came from Alabama, the father from Arkansas. They met up in the North outside of Chicago, settled in Gary, and you have all these things that would never have existed. All of those people were related to the Motown sound, which would not have existed had there been no Great Migration.
advancing the conversation to abolish racism for over 70 years. 94.1 KPFA. Lettucey.
It happens all the time like this. That one person will be right there. And she was just crying. All right. We were getting ready to sing. All right. I hadn't even got the words out. She was already in it. And her eye, she was not too far away, but I just had to tell her to come here. And I held her hand and sang. And I said, see, I had a bad day. I've been performing and I got it all out. And I forget what I do. See, you better remember.
Right.
This is why you're doing it. You belong here to do this. This is your calling, is to ignite something in people, to make them, let them know that they belong too. It's bigger than me. It always has been bigger than me.
KPFA, storytelling for social change.
This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, and 88.1 KFCF in Fresno.
For God's sake, Emerald. That may be true, but I'm married to your sister now. It's wrong.
Well, you always said you could never tell us apart, so let's just play a little game, you and I. Just pretend I'm Jade.
Oh, God, you're evil.
For once in your miserable life, you're exactly right.
Oh.
You know what I want? I want to see my father's new will. Get it for me. Now.
Anything. Anything you want.
Once this new will is destroyed, my father's old one, leaving the towers to me, will take effect when my father dies at midnight. You've been a good boy, Chet. Very, very good.
Chet, why so glum? Life goes on. Trust me.
God forgive me.
Oh, darling, don't be so morbid and tiresome. It's Jade who'll have to forgive you now. At midnight tonight, the towers will all be mine.
Wait a minute, baby. Let's get one thing straight. I didn't spend 18 months up the Amazon dodging blow darts for my health.
Correction, darling. The towers will be all ours.
That's more like it.
Jade!
Just pick the most beautiful flowers. Chet, what's wrong? Hello, sister. Emerald.
Hello, beautiful.
Montana, my God, what are you doing here? Have a seat, Jade. Montana, pour Jade a drink. I think she's gonna need it.
Emerald, please, don't do this.
Chet? Where's Daddy? What's this all about?
Relax, baby. Everything's cool.
I think it's time we all had a nice talk.
Tune in tomorrow for Invitation to Love.
But I never go free till Mardi Gras. Sent my wife a $20 bill. If you wanna get it, I bet the shotgun will on Mardi Gras.
That sounds good, officer.
Who is that man that's riding that horse? I don't know his name, but they call him Boss on Mardi Gras.
I'm not gonna do it.
Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody don't want to die. I went down to hell and they say I was swell, but they don't want me down in hell, so I'm making better ravens, so I'm walking up to heaven, 11 million miles from there.
Special Agent Chester Desmond disappeared without a trace. This is one of Cole's Blue Rose cases. The clues that were found by Special Agent Desmond and Agent Stanley have led to dead ends. The letter that was extracted from the fingernail of Teresa Banks gives me the feeling that the killer will strike again.
I'm talking to you. Thank you.
This is a really beautiful day, a very interesting time, and an interesting turn of events. I'm sitting here with Laura Palmer. Laura, you've been dead for over 25 years. And I'd like to ask you, what is life for you now? And what are your feelings and thoughts, memories of your time with your mother and father?
There's a lot of things that people don't know. It's the same way with me. Sometimes even much less than half is known. Sometimes more. I used to love horses. Many things happen. Many things all at once, like a circus with dark creatures at night with flickering lights, and I knew a man named Bob, and when he came to visit me, I knew that my life was over. And then there was a time when I cried because I was so happy. Because I saw what it was. And it was so beautiful. I was awake. There are still questions. Questions about the truth of it all. I meet many people with no names.
Bless your heart.
Probably the song that you two are best known for in this collaboration is Laura's theme from Twin Peaks, and I wonder if you could describe for us how that song
it's really kind of interesting. David then came to me in my office and said, I've got this television show to do, a pilot for ABC. At the time it was called Northwest Passage. And I said, what is it? He said, it's a Blue Velvet soap opera.
We're in a dark woods now, and there's a soft wind blowing through some sycamore trees.
Okay, that makes sense.
And there's a moon out, and there's some animal sounds in the background, and you can hear the hoot of an owl.
What should the music be? And he said, well, you know, I have an idea.
And you're in the dark woods.
That the music should be very dark and ominous at the beginning. It should have many sections to one theme. And if you capture this, it would be just wonderful. It would be peachy keen, okay? So he says it should be very dark and ominous and sustained, and then let that maybe a minor feel and segue into this beautiful anticipatory theme, you know, that climbs ever so slowly, that would reach a climax that should tear the hearts out of people.
You know, just get me into that beautiful darkness with the soft wind. And I started playing.
And as he was describing this, three quarters through it, and then let that climax fall ever so gently down, and then maybe make it segue into this dark, ominous theme.
And David would say, Angelo, that's great. I love that. That's a good mood. But can you play it slower? And I'd say, slower, David?
My fingers just went to the keyboard, and I started this kind of thing. And he was talking to me, and it's got to be dark, and it's got to be sustained, and it's got to be oh so beautiful, you know, and very slow. And so I had to play even slower than that. And
okay.
And then,
and I'd go,
I'm so bored.
He says, that's it. That's a good tempo. Just keep it going slow like that.
It just developed, and I'll just show you what came out of that.
Just keep that going for a while. And in David's mind, you can just see that he was visualizing the description that he envisioned.
Mind of David Lynch comes a modern-day masterpiece so startling, so provocative, so mysterious that it will open your eyes to a world you have never seen before.
Then he would say, okay, Angelo, now we gotta make a change, because from behind a tree in the back of the woods, there's this very lonely girl. Her name is Laura Palmer. And it's very sad. But get something that matches her. And I just segued into this.
Our next movie is named Blue Velvet. And already this movie has caused a firestorm around the country, with some advanced reviews calling it a masterpiece and others calling it sick and depraved, and still others calling it a sick, depraved masterpiece. The movie takes place in a small town where a young couple stumbles over a mystery that begins with the discovery of a severed human ear and leads them to suspect that the ear might belong to the missing husband of a local nightclub singer. ¶¶
That says you played it the very first time.
Just the very first time. And what happened was that David looked at me and said, Angela, don't change a note.
Did you ever stop to think what a strange world this would be if suddenly all the birds stopped singing?
You've captured 75% of the mood of Twin Peaks.
Have you ever watched a bird fly? Of course you have.
I see Twin Peaks. Closer. Just keep building it. Just keep building it. And she's getting close. Now reach some kind of climax. And I would go, and he said, oh, that's it. Oh, that's so beautiful. Angelo. Oh, that's tearing my heart out. I love that. Just keep that going. Now she's starting to leave. To fall down. Keep falling. Falling. Now go back into the dark woods. That's it. Keep going. Just keep it going. Very quiet and mysterious. David, wait, you know, this was just like ad-libbing. I said, I have to work on it. David got up, gave me a big hug. He said, Angelo, that's Twin Peaks. I said, okay, David, I'll go home and I'll work on it. He said, Angelo, please don't change a note. Don't do a thing and don't change a signal note. Now, one thing I learned about David is when
My name is David Lynch, and I would like to tell you how Pinky's Bubble Egg came into being.
Not really a musician.
In a dark world, just this side of our own, in the land of the shadows, a short, stocky, yet twisted-looking male gnome castrated a small fairy dog. The wheezing moan, actually the air of the wheezing moan, which issued forth from the dog's nostrils, contained a faint melody of Pinky's Bubble Egg. Now this particular world, being very near and yet very far, has absolutely no connection to our present lives. So sometime in the distant future, when things have changed, some amber was dripping from a tree. Time passed, and geologists from a university found it as a prehistoric, petrified example worth keeping. And by accident, or at least for no expressed purpose, a rosin bow was pulled across the string of petrified amber, and the melody sounded forth once again. This time, not from the realm of dreams, but in what we call reality, which we all know is a joke.
Oh. I think what's exciting about the film, and it is challenging, is it starts out with flowers and sunlight, and it's a happy little town, and then we dig deeper and we find out it's a nasty town, or at least a couple of people are nasty. And I sat there, and this did for me, and I use the Psycho example again, this did for me what Psycho did as a lot younger, which is eyes open and, oh my God, we're really getting in over our heads. And that's an experience which is challenging, shocking, but mesmerizing, and I like the picture.
Well, first of all, I don't think I'm on the wrong tack with Isabella Rossellini. In the first place, the movie was shot in two halves, so she had no idea, making her part of the movie, that all of the stuff outdoors and in the daylight was going to be smarmy and campy and funny with all kinds of in-jokes. And secondly, it seems to me that we can't divorce our reactions. It's not how Isabella Rossellini reacts to the fact that she's standing there nude and humiliated on the lawn of the police captain's house with lots of people watching. It's how I react. And that's painful to me, to see a woman treated like that. And I want to know that if I'm feeling that pain, it's for a reason that the movie has, other than simply to cause pain to her.
Well, I think that the reason is that the film is a thriller and a shocker. I mean, there are people that get hurt badly in real life, and I think that this is a legitimate one. This is not a simple mad slasher
movie.
Then
why is it a comedy?
Because he wants to set you up. He's a director, and he wants to play you like all the directors, the great directors want to do. He wants to play you like a piano, which is have you smile and then swing you right into the... some depression.
Yeah, well, the next time somebody wants to play me like a piano, he better get some music that's worth listening to.
I think this is a good song.
Do you think that he has inspired you to do things that you wouldn't have done?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I've never written such slow music in my life. And there is a dark side of me. There's no doubt about it, because in my film score writing, I like to write things that, you know, have some darker kind of things underneath the surface of a melodic line or stuff like that, and bittersweet things. I just love it. And but David's descriptions have just brought out another side of some musical composition, I guess, which I try to write the most beautiful kinds of melodies that you can play with, you know, one finger to make stand on its own, I think, can really reach people. But once again, underneath all of that, on a lot of the music in Twin Peaks, there are many elements.
Stay tuned for part two of Invitation to Love.
Jade, here's to old times. Should old acquaintance be forgot? More than you know.
While you were away, I prayed you'd die. Out there in the rainforest, that there'd be a rafting accident, or you'd run into a group of hostile natives. Something you couldn't handle.
Baby, I haven't met anything yet I can't handle.
Oh, yeah? Let's see how you handle this.
Hey, gentle buddy, relax.
Jade, you better go make that call now.
Take it easy.
I'm warning you, Montana. You ruined my first marriage. But to tell you the truth, Emerald was lost to me long before you ever drifted into our lives. But if you lay a hand on my wife, Jade, I swear, I'll kill you.
Invitation to Love will continue.
Thank you.
can't give you all my dreams, all the life I live. You and I know what friendship means. That's all we got to give. Who will take your dreams away? Takes your soul another day. They've stolen it away. Please don't stand too close to me. Can you hear my heart? Take my warmth and lean on me. When we're not apart, now our mission is complete. And our friends are here. Evil things brought down by the light. Life goes on until.
Could you tell us how life is for you now and share with us some memories or feelings of your time when you were with your husband and your daughter?
Now? Well, it's about the same, I guess. I mean, obviously, it's not. But the house is basically the same. There are lots of things falling apart. I can tell you that much, for sure. Lots of things. But I can still make the happy face when I go to get my hair done or to the grocery store. And I mean, no one really knows what I'm thinking. Or cares. That's the thing. Step aside. I've seen people. Some of them in the medical profession. But that doesn't really matter. A lot of the memory is gone. I keep up with football. I really like it. On TV. And billiards. Snooker. And I like to watch bowling.
Thank you, Sarah.
Was a stranger in the city, out of town, where the people I knew. I had that feeling of self-pity. What to do? What to do? To do. The outlook was decidedly blue, but as I walked through the foggy streets alone, it turned out to be
everywhere.
Unlike the Baroque masterworks, 19th century pieces such as the Beethoven symphonies are usually so long and melodramatic that the average listener
has to be informed through the use of program notes as to what's going on. In order to prevent him from falling into a confused
slumber. Thank you.
Jerry and I would like to bring you
what we call a moment of truth behind some commercial messages you all may have seen on your TVs.
Touch.
Joan Baez.
I think we have to talk about words just a little bit, and I would take the word peace, because I think we all have a very wrong and confused notion of what peace means. Peace at this stage, probably all you and I have ever known of peace is nothing to do really with peace, but rather a waiting time between wars, or a time for us when no bombs are dropping on our heads. But peace is not something static. Peace is not something that we will arrive at someday, I don't think. I think that peace is a way we have to act, a way we have to arrange our lives to effect change.
Storytelling for Social Change on KPFA. Jack Hirschman.
And that people both older and younger than you, a billion strong, will say, we don't want you to make war anymore anywhere on earth. If you do, we will stop you and your weapons of mass destruction without even a shot being fired. We're the majority. You're an unruly child. Go to the corner and learn your lesson. Then, America, finally, you'll be free.
Storytelling for Social Change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org.